So tonight is the first time that we're doing this. I want to thank Matter. Matter is letting us host here, which is awesome. But there isn't anyone from the team here, but if you see them around, if you know who they are, say thank you to them. OpenMHealth provided all the food and the drinks, and they're going to be doing a small welcome as well. My name is Miraj Choski. I'm one of the organizers of the OpenMHealth Chicago Meetups. I'm also a co-founder of Varsa Health, which is a Matter member company. It's where I lead product design and development for them. If you have any questions about what I do outside of this, or if you're interested in helping organizing future events with OpenMHealth, just come up to me afterwards. Or if you're on the Meetup, just click contact organizers on there, and they'll shoot me an email, and then we can get in touch. Because we definitely need some help. We want to be doing this as often as possible. We are the fourth meetup after New York, San Francisco, and London. And then we'll also be having a large summit in San Francisco next week. So before we start, I wanted to just get an idea of like who's in the audience. I know we have a mix of Matter member companies here. I see some familiar faces. We have some developers too, maybe some designers, some folks from the industry, so that's awesome. I hope you guys had a chance to get some food. Please help yourself afterwards as well. There's plenty of it. So today we have some great speakers. We have Dr. Neelum Aggarwal and Dr. Siddiqui, two folks who are providing some really different perspectives. Dr. Neelum Aggarwal is going to be really providing a perspective on the clinical side of things, and Dr. Siddiqui is going to be giving an idea of what it's like to work in this industry and the work he's doing. I'll give a little bit more detail afterwards, but first off, I wanted to introduce David. David is one of the co-founders and is also the executive director of OpenMHealth. So he's with us virtually. So he's not in the room right now, but what I'm going to do is pull up a Google Hangout. So I'm going to move him over and then switch to audio. So give me like 2 minutes.
Hey, everyone.
Hi.
I'm sorry to have my headphones on. I'm at SFO Airport. I just touched down a little bit ago. But I wanted to say thank you for doing this, Miraj, and the Matter folks. This is really exciting. I think sometimes we plan and plan and plan for various things, and it's really wonderful when things happen organically, when people are interested in what it is that you're doing and want to actually help to make this a thing all across the world. And we really want to thank Miraj and Matter folks for hosting this event tonight. And again, I apologize in advance for any background noise from the airport. But this is really great, and we're really excited that the Open Meetup is spreading to Chicago. I wanted to give a little bit of, like, just, well, maybe we can mess with the slides a bit, Miraj?
Yeah, sure.
The slide 3. Like Miraj mentioned, we're actually going to be having our OpenMHealth Summit next week in San Francisco. If you go to omhsummit15.eventbrite.com, you can take a look at a little bit of the agenda and of who's going to be there. It's going to be a fantastic group of product managers, data scientists, doctors, developers, health system administrators, and a bunch of different folks, which is really our community. People trying to really disrupt the space, trying to come up with an alternative way to use digital health data. And so we're really excited about next week, and I know Miraj is going to be there repping Chicago, and I'm sure he'll be able to report back to the meetup here. And we're really excited that he's coming, and if others are going to come, thanks for coming. Next slide. As always, OpenMHealth is hiring a software engineer. So if you're interested in becoming one, just apply at the link below, bit.ly/softeng backend. And we'd love to hear from you. You can email me at david@openmhealth.org if you're interested. I also, next slide. I did want to just mention, just to kind of echo Miraj's point, that Chicago is the fourth meetup. Let's give a round of applause for that, by the way. That's awesome. Okay. Anyway, But there is a committee, the London Meetup is growing. I think it's, if you look down the bottom, there's about 157 people in the London Meetup, and they have about, it's tomorrow. So if you know anyone in London that should be there, you should definitely tell them to go to the local meetup. It's gonna be great. And the folks that we're co-organizing with us, they're a design research company that does behavioral interventions. So I can't really say anyone, but I did want to give a little bit of an overview about what is open mHealth and why it is that we're doing what we're doing. Maybe next slide. So our mission is to unlock the potential of digital health data so that it can be meaningful in a clinical environment. What do I mean by that exactly? So, you know, when we think about a lot of these different apps and devices that are coming to market, they're building their solutions that really need, whether it's activity tracking or sleep or something having to do with the brain or, you know, your health app or whatever it might be. We all know these different devices are coming to market, but they all are developing their data in these various silos. And what ends up happening is that when we're really trying to get any meaning from this data, and especially in the clinical sense, there's not going to be one app that's going to solve any one. It's going to tell a story about any one person. We know that there is a lot of context to someone's health. That, you know, I'm in the airport right now. I've been walking for the last 6 hours, and some activities were very low, and I just ate a salad. And what is it? How do we bring all these different feedback into a way that I can help to interpret what my health story is? And what we really believe in open health is that we can unlock this potential of this data, so it could be meaningful to both patients and clinicians. Next slide. What we do though is we build community, but more importantly is we build open source code that helps developers save time in using this data, whether it's to standardize the data, process the data, visualize, integrate, or whatnot. Next slide. I'm going to give a little bit of this is a bit of a sneak peek of our website, so that it's going to come out next week or at the end of this week, but give you a little bit of a few slides just to show this. A lot of things are possible with open mHealth, and our framework platform, our open source platform, really can help you do the whole gamut of things with this digital health data. You can standardize the data. We have a set of JSON schemas that are clinically valid, and what I mean by that is that we really work hard with a lot of clinical experts from various domains, whether it's cardiology or pharmacy or whatever it might be, and we try to understand what are the metrics that matter to them, and then try to find the clinical standards that help to reference those metrics. So, for example, if we wanted to represent minutes of moderate activity and blood pressure, we would talk to a bunch of cardiologists, represent the blood pressure measure, and then represent a clinical standard of others, or whatnot. And we do that with a lot of different measures. You can go to our website and see those as well, but those can be in the section of the developers. There's also a way, we also have a way to store the data. Let's say you want to place data, but we don't host it, but if you needed to place the store the data that allows you to authenticate different solutions, we also have a solution as well. Next slide. A lot of people are really interested in this. We have a way to also integrate disparate data streams. So we have connections now to Fitbit, Jabra, Runkeeper, Moves coming out, as well as Google Fit, iHealth, Misfit, and HealthKit. So this is just a really simple open source way that you having to act in a bootstrap way, but it's actually being used in production. To actually access all these different data sources and have that data be conformed to our schemas, which I mentioned earlier. Next slide. Now, let's say you were an app or device yourself and you're building your own solution and you didn't have an API and wanted to be able to share your data with other Fitbits and the Jablans of the world have their own APIs that they share with others. We have a way to do that so that you can give your data to folks and then they can conform. They would also conform to the schema. Next slide. Once you've been able to access this data, you've invaded it, you've stored it, now comes the fun part. It's when we want to actually process it. So now that you have this processing, we have modules that we'll be releasing this summer for very simple things like doing basic, you know, arithmetic basically. But that is data and do something with it. Next slide. This is always the thing that people are most interested in are once you have the process data and you have all this data sources and it's all conforming to a clinically valid schema, you can actually visualize it. So as part of the website, we'll have some examples of various measures like blood pressure and weight and whatnot. Like some of the clinical considering be able to represent those measures and then have some of the JavaScript and HTML to be able to do that and create that data. And that's really where a lot of the value from open mHealth is that we provide these building blocks for you to be able to actually build a solution using this data from these disparate sources. I encourage you to go to github.openmhealth.org to take a look at some of the type of offerings that we have. As I mentioned earlier, we launched the website, so you'll be able to see all this in one place in a short period of time. But I did want to just say thank you so much to Miraj and the Matter folks for hosting this meetup. We're truly honored, and we hope that you get a lot out of tonight. And I'm really excited to watch the video, and hope to see you next week, or we'll just see you very soon. Keep up the good work. Bye.
Okay, cool. Thanks. So they're gonna go. Can everyone hear me if I'm not using the mic in the back? Awesome. Okay. So we're going to start with the first speaker is going to be Dr. Neelum Aggarwal. She's a clinical researcher and neurologist at Rush University Medical Center. She's going to give the perspective of a clinician and the work that she's done with mHealth internationally and locally. So, Dr. Neelum Aggarwal.
So I'm a neurologist, I'm a population neurologist, which means I'm in the field. I'm in the field, I'm in people's homes, I'm on the south side, west side, and north side of the city. We've done about 2,500 home visits for our population studies. And these studies are like epidemiological studies, okay? So these are studies where we're actually asking questions about memory. We're asking questions about physical function. We're doing EKGs in the house. We're doing blood draws in the house. We're using accelerometers. We're using all these devices to see, as older people, how do they age? And are they aging well? And if they're not aging as well as we expect them to, what is going on with them? So this has been going here in Chicago since 1996. We've had multiple population studies here in the city that many people don't know about, but there's good data from that. By being in the house, I have been able to go ahead and collect a lot of data and look at the data and see what people can do in the house and what people can't do in the house. And I think it's really important when you start thinking about mobile devices, whether you're going to be doing sensors, you're going to be wearing watches, what can people do reliably, what can people do easily, and how are you transporting that data back? Typically, we do things on laptops, we collect the data on laptops, and then we'll use a thumb drive. And what I've noticed, especially in our underserved communities, is that a lot of the devices that we're coming up with, that we're hearing about, a lot of the people are not using. They're asking their kids to do it. So, this is my first take-home message. If a device is going to be targeted, know your target audience and know what they're doing. I'll give you an example. When I talk to people and I ask them, if you got a reminder from the doctor about something, let's say take your medicine, what kind of phone do you want? The answer I get? The flip phone. I don't want a smartphone. It's too busy for me. It's too hard for me to work with. Now, when I go to India, where my relatives are from, Same thing, the simple, the most simplest phone around to get information. Yet the kids are coming over with more smartphones. Okay? So be very careful in understanding your audience, what they're accessing, what they're not accessing, and what their kids are accessing. Other thing here in Chicago, who has internet and who doesn't? A lot of older people are going to the library to connect with internet. They're going to the Department on Aging. They are not going. They don't have it in the house. And I see that in the house, because I'm in the house. So I'll say, how are you getting your information? Television, radio. So keep that in mind, okay, when you do the population kind of work or when you're doing community work. Now, when you're in the hospital, same thing. So now I'm in the clinic in the hospital. I'm a neurologist. I'm doing cognitive testing. I'm trying to communicate information to my patients, and they're not on some of these. So my chart, which is really big right now, where you can access your medical records, a lot of my patients don't want it. They'll access how the kids do it. Okay? So as I was in the field, and as I've been working in the field and looking at what's happening here, I got involved with a non-for-profit called Aerobia World. And the CEO, Nalini Saligram, is here in Chicago, and she's recently relocated temporarily to Canada. But it's basically a global non-for-profit, but I want to show you a couple things about this non-for-profit, what we're doing, because it has really impact here for a very common chronic, what we call non-communicable disease, diabetes. Diabetes is huge, by the way. By the way, there's no such thing as not being diabetic. You are pre-diabetic. I hate to say that, but it's true. Everybody is pre-diabetic. If you don't watch what you eat and if you do not exercise, here comes an MD now coming out, you can develop diabetes. So you have to be very careful when you talk about diabetes. But Aerobia World was looking at this issue in India, especially the diabetic epidemic in India. And basically, we're trying to change the course of chronic disease, and we're trying to figure out how to do it in a big scale way. Okay? So, you look at some of the statistics, if you read the statistics, it's incredible what's happening over there right now with the diabetes. And frankly, we probably have more diabetics in India than any other country in the world, which is surprising to a lot of people, because a lot of people will say to me, but aren't you vegetarian? How can that be? You can be a vegetarian and you can be diabetic. Okay. So this is the NCD impact, at least in India, and the economic impact is huge, because we're trying to figure out how are we going to manage this right now and how are we going to reach people. So if we have a healthy diet and exercise, we know we can bring down diabetes, and we know that 30 minutes of physical exercise is really where it's at. It really is where it's at, 30 minutes of physical exercise, and even with walking, okay? Walking has a tremendous impact. And if you do this kind of exercise, and walking particularly, you can reduce basically and prevent diabetes. And this is very important because it's now a lifestyle kind of feature that you're looking at. How are we going to do this? Well, this is what we did. We basically engaged a lot of leaders. We had prevention programs on the ground. And we basically had to figure out how are we going to get our message across. So what we developed was we thought we're going to go to mHealth. And what did we do? We did mobile health. We did an mDiabetes program on the phone. So we have mDiabetes text messaging on the phone reaching people. The carrier in India was Nokia. Nokia signed up to be the carrier, and we were able to basically look at, these are the partners. These were the partners we used. We used Emory for the text messaging, Johnson & Johnson, Aetna. We had the schools involved, we had workplace involved, we had women involved, but we started to think about this mDiabetes model and wondering how are we going to translate what we do on the phone and where are we going to take it. So, here's what's happening right now. When we started to do this, you can see right here, we had schools. And we started to work with the schools, and we started to also, in tandem, work with all the Nokia users. So here's what happened, it was so interesting. Nokia had a program that said, when you sign up to Nokia in India, do you want to get lifestyle messaging? And you had an opt-in. And if you opted in, you got messages. The text messages came out 3 times a week, especially, are you diabetic, yes or no? Again, flip phone, yes or no. Then it said, do you take medicine for diabetes, yes or no, yes, no. Then the messages started to come out. The messages were given, did you walk today? That was the first message, yes, no. Then the other message came in, when you choose food, did you choose a rice or did you choose bread? Yes, no. And we, and again, it's a self-report, but the point is we had 1 million text messages. We've now done over 23 million text messaging up there, and we now have data coming back on this. The text messaging data from just reaching people these simple, simple questions is now showing that, number one, people are changing their habits. So as we worked through this and we started to do this, we figured 1 to 2 years, 2 to 3 years, and 4 years, here's how we can now take that mDiabetes program and make it work. So the Clinton Global Initiative picked it up. We have got funding from Cigna, but this is a program that is working on a simple, basic question. Did you do this? Didn't you do this? And I think it's really important to understand that we're now into, from diabetes, into 2.0, which of course you would probably expect. And guess where we're headed? Heart disease and stroke. Because what comes from diabetes? Heart disease and stroke. So now we have stroke messaging. Same way. Did you take your heart medicine? Did you check your blood pressure? Did you walk? Yep.
Is this used only in India or in the United States?
Right,
also?
Well, this is where. So I went local, I'm going global, and I'm trying to come back, and I'll tell you in a sec. But it's a good question because it's, here's the thing. This was done globally in a country where there are, what, 40 plus dialects in the language? And the biggest here issue that I get as a doctor when we want to do things, well, it's hard to go, we can't translate that. Okay? Can't get an informed consent translated into another language easy. We can't do other things in languages easy. It doesn't make sense to me. It doesn't make sense at all because over there, we're translating it into over 23 dialects we're already translated on Nokia, yes or no. Right from the north to the south of India to the east, west, you've got everything in between being translated. So it can be done. So when you hear the issues here, it's frankly, it won't, it just doesn't want to be done. Everything has to be English-based, and I'm really telling everyone here in this audience, we can't keep doing that. This country is diverse. This country has multiple ethnic groups. You cannot keep banging it on English all the time because you're not going to have good health outcomes, and that's what we're facing in the hospitals. People don't understand the language. So when we did there, we translated the language into the dialects. Now we're doing stroke, and now we're doing heart disease, and now we're trying to get behavioral change data. This data from mDiabetes right now is being looked at here. We have researchers here at Rush Northwestern looking at that data, and we're going to present it. Now, good question. Bring it back here. Why aren't we doing this right now in a big way on the south side? Why aren't we having this coming up on our phones as an option? Well, we're not sure why. We're trying to figure out who's going to be the carrier. Verizon was interested at one point to kind of partner here to see this model and to see how can you do this? How can we reach all these people on mHealth? I can tell you right now what's happening is that we're looking to develop an app, and we want to have an app developed because what we're developing the app for? Food. Food. We want to develop an app to see what people are eating, why are you eating what you're eating, and why, and let's make it culturally sensitive, in this case, to the Indian diet. So the app is going to be developed into mHealth. We're making it like what our traditional dish or our plate would look like. So as I'm coming back here and I'm on the south side and I see people playing, you know, games on their phone and solitaire on their phone, and doing all these things, and I'm often wondering as a doctor, why is that? Why can't we do something meaningful? We're having the biggest issues with the carriers, that the carriers are not helping us trying to develop this here. We do have a market here in Chicago. We have a lot of community members here, but that seems to be the issue right now, getting the carrier and bringing that here in a cultural sensitive way. Yep.
Have you gone to the manufacturers of the phones, just added on as a bulkware?
Yeah, so we have talked to some of the manufacturers of the phone and saying, can we add this on? And again, it goes into this kind of a, well, who's going to get it? Are you going to give the person the phone versus them signing up for it? That's where we got one hang up. Are you going to give the phone out? And we're trying it now through stroke. Because stroke is one thing right now. You can, you know, the data is really high for diabetes, but stroke is even higher. When you have these risk factors, you have an increased risk of stroke. So if we can get in the stroke prevention model, we may have a better luck right now. Right now, the model for diabetes prevention, diabetes care, is at the hospital-based, and you hear it all the time. The hospital-based program. You have to go to the hospital. You're learning about the hospital. You're going to the why to get this. The next approach for us is going to try to really talk to the phone manufacturers again and see what they can do and take this model from India and bring it back here. Yep.
You know that there are phones for old folks that can be really cheap.
Mm-hmm.
How about them accepting?
You know, I think the if we did the phone for the old folks, as you're saying, and you're right, they're cheap and they're easy to use, it's exactly what they want. Then we would have to get the messaging, we would have to find someone here who could do that simple messaging with the language and see if we can bring it here. And I think we could. I think we could. We're going to keep looking at into it, okay? But I wanted to just show you, I can only be up here for a few minutes, but I wanted to show you, this is a global thing we're trying to bring local. We're not trying to bring it local, take it global. And I don't think we do enough of it. I don't think we look globally to other countries what they're doing. Africa, India, places where there's huge distances to cover, rural distances to cover, and we're still having issues here in an urban center on the south side and the west side where people say it's almost, I might as well almost be in a rural area because I feel like it, because they don't have access. So, you have a question in the back?
I'm just wondering why you approach, concentrate on approaching the carriers and manufacturers. Unless you, unfortunately, you know, those organizations aren't, should I say, the most philanthropic organizations. Unless they can see a direct commercial benefit from it, they're probably not going to get involved. Now, that could be that they see that they either get some extra business,
yeah,
or it's going to be very good marketing or something, but they're not going to go out of their way. I don't think they'll go out of their way to help in this country, and I don't think you're going to get any corporations.
Well, it is exactly what you're saying. It's happening here in that way, and I think over there in India when it happened, it was the volume of customers that you would be able to get.
Yeah.
Because it is so overwhelmingly, the diabetes is so overwhelmingly prevalent there.
And you know, the carriers aren't interested in flip phones.
Exactly.
You know, they're not making any money out of that. They want people to have data contracts, they want smartphones. So,
exactly.
So that's a model that they're not going to be. But maybe, you know, if it's about finding somebody or an organization to help fund this sort of service, then I would suggest looking for organizations that would benefit in some way. So maybe health insurance companies, maybe Medicare, you know, might fund
It's a really good point about, you know, who's interested in what. So when you talk about like prevention or health prevention, the World Health Organization has picked this up. Okay, so the World Health Organization has picked up this program, saying that they haven't seen this massive numbers of people being text messaged. And actually, here's the kicker with all this. It's called behavior change data. This is the problem with all of this, and you know that. How do you demonstrate behavioral change versus getting the text messages? Are you totally blowing them off and you're not looking at them because they're keep coming in, just the way we do with emails, right? Okay. So the biggest issue here is how do you demonstrate that? So we have demonstrated that, where we are seeing change in behavior. I self-report again, okay? World Health Organization picked it up, and we're hopeful that now that they've looked at this and they want this program, we can now put it on a national prevention platform, and as you said, then you go into the carriers, then you go into the health insurance, et cetera. Stroke is where I think it should go, because stroke is the massive cost to the whole economy, plus the hospital with stroke. Not only just with the stroke, the disability that comes from stroke. Yeah.
What population are you targeting for stroke, meaning after they hit a certain age, meaning they're pre-stroke,
yeah,
or they've already had one stroke and they're likely to have another stroke?
So this is going to be a prevention for stroke. So we can't, again, we're targeting it in India first.
Yeah.
We cannot go, we don't know. We don't know what they have, but we're assuming it would be pre-stroke. That you are at risk by these cardiovascular and diabetic risk factors for having a stroke. And so that would be it. It would be probably older. Yep.
Quick question. Correct me if I'm wrong, but my impression is that type 2 diabetes in developing countries such as India is more likely to be a middle class or upper class problem, whereas here it is more likely to be a lower socioeconomic class problem. Is that?
It's changing.
That's changing?
Yeah, that is changing. And that's a good question. So in India we're seeing the thin diabetic. So when you say thin, a lot of times you think about people who are not eating as much and not eating as well versus, you know, the obese diabetic, okay? So it is changing there, and it seems that, you know, in general, we are at more risk of developing diabetes because of metabolic syndrome. This thing called metabolic syndrome. So as an ethnic group, we tend to have higher risks. We have higher risks of cardiovascular disease also, okay? So I think here, you know, whether or not it's a lower or upper, it's there. The prevalence of it is so much. And that's when I started off. There's no such thing as not being diabetic. Seriously. You are pre-diabetic to an extent. You have to pay attention to this. You have to pay attention to what you eat. Because it doesn't take, frankly, much to tip you over based on the foods that you're eating, the processed stuff that's going on, and what we think is causing it. This is an Indian problem, an Asian problem, Indian, Japanese, Chinese. So if you look at a health issue like this in a mobile health technology, you want to be looking at Asia and Pacific areas because the population is really, really high. So I'm going to let Dr. Siddiqui get up here and do his thing, and then I will take questions. He's patiently waiting, right? All right, so thank you. We'll take your questions.
Actually, we're gonna have like a Q&A thing in that, so you guys will have an opportunity to ask questions. Stick around afterwards too. So speaking of bringing things locally, so Dr. Khan Siddiqui is the founding CEO and CTO of HIGI. He'll talk a little bit more about what they do and what he's working on and what he's been working on, and it's bringing everything to the local. So Dr. Khan Siddiqui.
These awesome demos show, you know, how much data can come in from all these wearable sensors running on the, you know, the EC2 cloud in Amazon, and then at 3:30 p.m. my demo stopped working, and I realized, you know, kids are out of school, so my 13-year-old decides he wants to do a Minecraft party of hosting on EC2. It shuts down my instance to scale his instance to extra large instance so he can support his 15 friends joining in, and unfortunately doing a demo, and what are you about doing backups and stuff, and lost all my code from last night. So anyway. So, you know, I forgot, she was out. Now my EC2 is in risk, otherwise they're not allowed to use it during school hours. Oh. So I'll, as Miraj said, I'm the also founding CEO of HIGI and now I'm the CTO of HIGI, both in the product development. I'm a radiologist by training, practice for a long time, associate professor at Johns Hopkins, and still am actually. For HIGI, I was at Microsoft, ran a platform engineering team for the health group, but did a lot of the work in the Connect algorithms, Azure cryptography, Windows 8 compression, a bunch of other pieces also. So, and I'm doing software development since I was 15 years old. I sold my first software out of high school. It was examined. So I've been doing this for a very long time. Anyway, so HIGI. It's not projecting. It's
fine.
I'm on PowerPoint too.
Yeah.
No,
I hope. Yeah, I think.
Okay. So what he does is he builds tools and services and data for engagement, for partners to engage better with their customers. So being a healthcare provider or any other industry, you're trying to engage with your audience, we build tools and services for that. One of the tools is our kiosk. We build our own kiosk that we put in grocery stores and pharmacies across the U.S. That has biometric screening for cardiovascular, obesity. We connect with around 65 plus tracking devices and apps. We build a engagement platform with gamification, challenges, rewards, type of activities to be able to incentivize and motivate users, and then provide analytics on these tools across different platforms. So we started March 2012. We are now 10,000 locations nationwide in retail stores, around 40 major retail brands. To date, we've probably done 122 screenings on our network. People have tracked 18 plus million miles on our platform. These data numbers are a little bit outdated. And then 19 million individuals have repeatedly used our station since we launched. So we've grown pretty fast in this space. So the whole idea of HIGI really is to help people, you know, build small, meaningful habits by doing small, tiny things in the whole idea of the whole philosophy to do it. And we realized earlier on, and especially when I was Microsoft trying to, last year Microsoft actually was responsible for the health of team and getting consumers engaged in the healthcare, but we realized that this will never be solved by one entity or one person. You really have to work, you know, really have to have everybody engaging with the consumer around different aspects of it to do it. So it could be the hospital engaging with you, your provider, your family, your pharmacist, your retailer, other folks in the audience. If they focus and incentivize and motivate you, that's magnitude effects and what can create to do that. So we decided to build these solutions for all these communities to better engage with the audience. And if you've read or if you study the behavior science literature around the stuff, the whole idea of persuasion, which is what Robert Walsh did with text messaging type of applications, is one factor that nudges people along, but the one is social influence. So we're trying to combine both the persuasion aspect of it and social influence aspect of it using all the research that is out there in both spaces to change these habits. So our goal really is to take uninformed, unengaged individual and move them to educate and engage through small, meaningful engagement steps that we deliver through our partners. Why did we focus on the kiosk? So as our Aggarwal said, you know, we immediately earlier on realized when we created the platform to do engagement, we wanted to connect devices. But when we looked at actual data, what we realized that healthcare costs, the majority of it is for people who are more than age 45. And in 2012, all the things you heard about Aggarwal about not using mobile phones and all those were true. And then also low socioeconomic status. People making less than $3,000 the household income are the majority of the healthcare costs. So if we had to cater that market, we had to have affordable, accessible, convenient solution for them. And that's why we looked at different aspects of it and realized how much these folks are actually using. Old blood pressure machines that have existed since the 1980s to do a lot of their care. So. But it's funny to see how that all has changed in the time frame we've been around. So we do this on a daily basis. So our demographic today is on all stuff is moving more and more elderly. So we used to be more younger in 2012 time frame. Now it's gone more elderly. Now it's gone more. I mean, you made the comment when you look at 2015 data, our shift is drastic from 2015. How many elderly have smartphones? How many elderly are using it? So. For example, one of our partners is Dollar General, right? These are targeting low socioeconomic status. 75% of people walking into Dollar Store today have a smartphone. So all those, I'm not sure how old your data is on when you capture test us, but in the US, 2015 data is very, very different from how it was even for us. And our whole model has changed around, so people are more going into smartphones, especially elderly population. And it was so funny when we started in 2012, we have a touch screen on our kiosk, and elderly would go like, what do I do? Here's the button to press to get started. And you know, we just say, touch the screen. It's like, what about the fingerprints? Like, it'll get dirty. You don't touch TVs. Now, it's like, this thing doesn't move. My iPad moves so fast. It's the same people giving us the feedback. So in just 3 years, how much of technology adoption and things have changed for us. It's been amazing how drastic that is.
That's
I would not
have. Absolutely. Okay.
Absolutely.
And across the country.
Absolutely.
Socioeconomic
status.
Really cool.
We cater a lot to this group and that group.
That's
so that's what our peak users are. We've seen drastic increase in device usage around those folks. So, and this is again improving. So don't get discouraged by building technology and tools for elderly. Eventually adoption happens. Just for the, it's all about timing. If we had done maybe 3 years ago, we probably would not be able to do all this stuff. And why did we focus on obesity and hypertension, cardiovascular? It's very obvious. I'm not going to, you guys all know this stuff, so I'm not going to do that. But our goal really was that this platform to be able to build partners to better engage. We did not think if we went alone to do it, we would be able to get the right audience or enough penetration to be able to reach the mass. I mean, if you think about how smoking cessation has changed drastically, right? So now it has become normative, what's called normative influence, meaning that it's normal not to smoke. So if you now smoke, you're suddenly the person outside the building and you're seen negatively, and a lot of the social change has happened, and it's interesting to see how that changes drastically happens. So the goal is you need to create that significant mass population doing certain habits before it becomes the norm to do it. So to do walk every day or do wearable every day or exercise every day till significant amount of population start doing it on a regular basis, it doesn't become a norm. So our goal really was to work with the partners to be able to do this stuff and then be able to be accessible, affordable, convenient, and accurate in what you do. So we don't have any self-reported data. It has to be machine-generated data that we capture. And obviously, it had to be simple, fun, and rewarding to be able to see any change. So in 3 years, this is a partner ecosystem. So anywhere from retailers to device partners to pharmaceuticals to employers who use us to health systems and all of the above. So we have significant penetration across the entire ecosystem of partners, and this keeps growing. We are in 5 continents right now, focusing on North America, expansion more ourselves, but if somebody comes from internationally, ask for them. I think we have around 50 devices in India. We have another 20 or so. So we do that. We don't like calling ourselves an IoT company, but that's exactly what we do. So Internet of Things really is, you have sensors that sense data, then you have analytics that analyze what to do with the sensors, and then you act on those data. So we bring data from our devices that are in different locations, retail provider, employer wellness spaces, even in airports. So, and home devices, so blood pressure devices and weighing scales at home, as well as fitness apps or devices that people carry themselves. And then we have cloud-based infrastructure where everything, all the stuff resides and highly scalable. And then we act on the data through our incentive platform where we can do challenges, rewards, gamification type of activities. The B2B platform for data APIs to have data flow into whoever needs it. And then we have messaging, so it's a HIPAA-compliant messaging platform, kind of an ad server, but it does educational messaging as well as you can target it based on what you're sensing and analyzing the data. There's a question at the back?
What is the gamification like?
So basically what we've done is look at research on what are the tools and versus technology and social influence that work. So for example, the most successful tool from a design, using UI design point of view that changes social engagement is leaderboard. Repeater studies have shown leaderboard is the most engaging tool.
Like making a competition between people.
So it aligns with what is called competitive influence. So not just that, but also competitive So there are 3, and how many people are familiar with all the behavior science research around this? So there are 7 influencers, social influencers that affect you, right? So competitive influence are the 2 that are affected by leaderboards, for example. Other one is the next one higher is recognition, so social recognition. So that's why all the badges and rewards that we offer is for you to win the badge and then post on your social media or HIGI to be able to get the recognition that you achieve that. Those 2 are the 2 that affect engagement. Then the other social influencers that affect participation or conversion, and the other that affect attitude change. So you need to think through how the research. What research shows and do the tools properly. We work from day one data driven, so we actually measure all the stuff all the time and see how we're impacting all these numbers. Actually, because I was in the demo, I deleted a slide that shows data on how the engagement numbers actually have shown improvement in blood pressure on 100 people, 54,000 patients in the last 1 year. Anyway, so that's our tools. Our platform. It's almost like it's 12 different products, if you think of it that way, but the personal health record, it's very interesting how we have a very unique way of storing how we store data in the open cloud. So it's completely open because we don't have a private cloud to save PHI, and we don't require Microsoft or Azure or Amazon to sign DA with us because of how we're storing data. We have our messaging platform, our data API, our incentives, both challenges and rewards. The whole management that does kiosk management, and then our whole notification system that has email, push notification, text messaging, and then data analytics, not only for reporting purposes, but also targeting for all our things on the left side here. So now we'll switch gears a little bit and talk about open mHealth, and especially in the context of open mHealth initiative that's going on here, and my learning. So as a radiologist, I was chair of the American College of Radiology's ID and Informatics Commission, responsible for standards on medical image standards and other things. So we started in the 90s, DICOM standard, really early to define medical imaging standards, and everything was great, and you know, standardized all the stuff till somebody at Hopkins did a 50,000 image CT scan on a carbon nanotube prototype scanner. Suddenly then all the standards went out the door because it created a bottleneck from a communication point of view, and you had to completely rethink about how do you actually standardize data. So I've gone from a enforcing standards, enforcing nomenclature to completely opposite now, and believing in more flexible architectures and unstandardized schema and schema-based architecture. So I ran multiple initiatives in standardization. There was another initiative called RADLEX, which is Radiology Lexicon, which I sponsored as part of the ACR and actually part of the bioportal bioontology. Defined it, and same issues have come up now. It's getting difficult to scale it in the current environment where other challenges are coming in. So what I talk about now, especially in that whole space, is that you need to be very flexible how you do handle the protocol that is communicating versus the content itself. And web is going to define what the protocol is going to be and what the best way to represent the protocol is, right? So today is JSON. JSON did not exist a few years ago, right? And was not popular. Tomorrow's going to be something else, and that's what everybody will be coding into. And it becomes very difficult when you think about which language, which protocol to use. You really have to be very flexible. And then what we do now, especially in the radiology side of things, we've gone away and we only have the college focused purely on the content portion of it. So what does it mean when you say systolic blood pressure? And how do you talk about it? Not about, or what data needs to be associated with it when you're talking about it. Not about how, not about which protocol to use, or is it a web service, is it something else? Or that really needs to be defined by what is the current status of it is. Otherwise, this becomes obsolete and you're reinventing every few years. We went through this in Microsoft also. So we supported the Blue Button project that the VA started. Idea was, again, standardize how we do it, the CCR, CCD. Idea started the same way to standardize how all these are, but then things change. Internet of Things comes in and all these things go out the door. So the rigid schema-based models break down when you get to highly distributed scalable systems. And data is coming so fast that you can't convert it without huge cost to you into certain aspects of it, right? High volume of desperate data. So for example, if you're getting blood pressure data from multiple devices, areas in which you can normalize blood pressure, even they're coming in the same place, it's very difficult to put them all together in the right context. What we switched over to, even in Microsoft, what we used to do is we moved to more of in-memory and on-demand schema. So basically, you optimize how you store data based on your cost constraints and which technology you're using. But then, when it's requested, you deliver the content in the schema that somebody is requesting for. So we would serialize it into Blue Button. We would serialize it into Open Health Initiatives. We would serialize it into any format as a CCD, serialize the CCR. However, you need it. The document gets data got serialized and pushed out on demand at the time of delivery. Because when you're requesting data one account per, especially that's the architecture. The helpful was that we had all this coming in very fast, but not pulling too fast, and you could actually do all those on demand things. Custom fields is a huge problem. So when you have a defined schema, then what do you do in custom fields? You just show right here. So here's the difference between the things. Blood, body scale data that is currently coming out from the scale versus what mHealth implementation, open mHealth implementation is, right? So obviously, you have no idea what this is. So first of all, the 79300 type 1 unit 3, like what does that even mean? And you have to have a look up table that defines what it is. That's actually weight. And I'm sure some developer did it without even realizing that nobody can weigh 9,000 kgs, right? So anyway, so I replicated it in the same way, so just to show an idea here. But it's very clear, it's more human readable when you're doing it, but you don't really care from a machine software development point of view, right? So you still have to understand body weight. So for me to write code to understand body weight is more than for me to write code that says type 1. So you know, it becomes challenging. This becomes more human readable and consumable, but it becomes really challenging. But then what do you do with all the other things? So this is weight we got. This fat-free mass, the fat ratio, and fat mass weight. Those are not supported here. So now if I'm ingesting that data, I have to extend this in a custom field, in a custom schema of my own. And tomorrow, OpenML comes up with a different one, all my data that's stored right now. What do I do with that? So I have a very hybrid, very custom implementation of OpenML that is only focused on my implementation there because all the data types and all things are not supported today. Another one is BMI. BMI is a calculated thing, right? So when you pulled it, at that time somebody, you store that data, you calculate on the fly. Those becomes another question to think about. So the next is unstructured data, right? This is great for structured data, but then what do you do with clinic notes? What do you do with all those other things that you're trying to store also? So if you're only building application that is using structured data, awesome. But then you go to much more blob type of data, blob actually binary large objects, not really blob, but so then becomes challenging. And the next thing are Internet of Things that is coming in. How many people went to Consumer Electronics Show this year? Guess how many wearable device vendors were there? Exactly. Anybody can guess? 5, 10, 20 something? 30. 30? How about 500? Right, so I mean, this is just a snapshot of it. There were 500 vendors at the Electronics Show just showing wearables in healthcare. Right, so next week the Electronics Show is probably going to blow that away because it's become very, very cheap. I'm not sure how people are keeping track on the Intel came out with Curie chip, which is a size of a button, which is a system on a chip that does accelerometer, gyroscope, everything. On a tiny little button size thing, and it's extremely cheap. It's, I think, like a couple of dollars just to get it. I think that's $10 for it. But the scale is even cheaper. So basically, every single fashion accessory, that's what Intel CTO talks about now, that he wants to convert every fashion accessory into a wearable. So all your earrings, all your, you know, anything you think of can become a wearable because power consumption technology improved also.
Question before you started speaking to someone, when I attended to. If I don't feel well and I Google what I have, it usually says I'm going to die within 2 to 3 days. So, my internist, I can email and she rates me back. So, we're in between. From an actual response from my doctor to WebMD that, you know, says I'm going to die in 2 or 3 days if I'm cold and not hungry. Where is all this?
So it's a very different context, right? These are all sensors that bring all the data for you or the doctor to then act on, right? I mean, so if you're not...
I'm not meaning specific to this slide. I'm just meaning specific to mHealth and
eHealth. Yeah, I mean, that's the whole idea, to make this more mobile and electronic to have access. So when you're not feeling well, how does your doctor know, in addition to just talking to you, your vitals are readily available to them. So you're not feeling well, without going to the doctor's office, how does he know what your blood pressure is right now, what your temperature is right now, and all that. That's what mHealth enables. It enables that real-time access to data if it's enabled, or if you have those devices at home to be able to share with doctors. That's where the future is. You know, when I'm talking about all these companies like Intel and everybody wants to convert anything that's at home into a sensor that measures all these things, right? So even like Wi-Fi routers, there's work going on that can detect somebody's behavior change or fall propensity just on fluctuations that are happening in the signal of Wi-Fi router. Right?
Is it going to be able to read blood tests?
So that stuff is going on too. You will be able to read non-invasively, do glucose and other things also. That is correct. So that's all happening. Probably won't happen tomorrow, probably won't happen in 5 years, but you know, 10, 25 years down the road, this is where all this research and technology is going in that direction. So let me finish this and I can go into more of this stuff. So this is what we want, right? We want very easy accessibility and all data coming together in one place and understand the context of everything without wires in the middle, right? And that's what mHealth and all these initiatives are doing. So I think the mHealth are great if you're trying to, these schema-based programs are very great if you're trying to build applications specifically to it to get started. As if this was available when HIGI started, we would have immediately jumped on it, but obviously as we've grown, we would have modified it and gone in our direction, but it really helps you start in that direction. So this is HIGI yesterday, right? These were, I forget how many now. This is all in the live demo, I'm showing it, but this was supposed to be a slide to go to the demo. Anyway, so these were just data that we collected yesterday. So we do around, it's like this is slightly more than 200,000 patients that used HIGI yesterday.
How many?
Pardon me?
How many did you say?
200,000, slightly more than 200,000 yesterday. So this is just the kiosk data. I mean, I'm not including all the wearable data. That is another beast of it. But we have real time that we can see what is happening. And I can actually predict what happened here. Right? Anything that is green is probably rain.
Yeah.
Right? So this is people who did not show up because of cold or weather-related reasons. Red is high usage. So our drought areas, really, really high usage in California. Florida, very high usage. It was a very good day yesterday in Chicago, so we had Midwest at very high usage. This is the exact correlation to weather data. Weather predicts more on usage than anything else. Not only that, but if you look at BP values, there's an awesome correlation. Your blood pressure value goes up by 10 mm mercury. You can become hypertensive in winter and normal in the summer. Just looking at the data, it's pretty impressive. Realizing multiple different languages, multiple different formats as you want to consume it. So if you have a Java-based application, C-sharp application, JavaScript, whatever it is, develop.hig.com, you can look at and reach out to us. I'm going to stop here.
Now we're just going to actually have the Q&A, so if you guys do have questions.
So it just depends on how you structure from day one. So, you know, the way we do have analytics, we map reduce based on, so we have a Hadoop-based infrastructure for our analytics, for example. So we map reduce for questions we're trying to ask. So the data that we look at actually is completely cleaned up as we're looking at, right? So next question somebody else, some partner comes and they want to ask something else, maybe one of the map reduce and stuff like that. So it's real-time data. So those issues only occur when you're, put all the stuff in and don't think about how you're going to look at data, but if you think of it from day one. So the two principles for us when we started was that we're going to be a data-driven company and we're going to be a privacy conscious company. So we have to make sure we cover all privacy, all security aspect of it. We're not going to do anything else. Otherwise, we're not going to make any decision without actual data available. So even if we go to business, we understand. So the other question was behavior change. It's really implementing all the tools that research has shown, nudge people, and then as part of the solution that our partners enable, we advise them or guide them on what tools to use to do it.
Yeah, but there's another element to that, though. You can have the tools, but in my experience, if it's not explained as from human to human, why this is important, what are we measuring, and what the outcome is, people aren't going to do it. And we're seeing that all across medicine right now. We have all these patient education materials. We have all this stuff. And yet I'm always astounded when I talk to people and say, so why aren't you taking your pressure medicine and trying to link pressure to kidney issues and to stroke? That link isn't there. That communication has to happen. So these, I think, are fabulous to have, but there has to be the communication link. And that's real important, because otherwise it's not going to happen.
And that's part of the tools that we have, right? So for example, if you look at why somebody needs treatment versus why we physically active, it's a completely different motivator. So five known factors of why you physically active, because you want to, it's fun to do, you want to feel good, you want to look good, you want to do it because it's social activity for you, and you feel that you're confident to be able to do it. So tell somebody to run a marathon, they're not going to run it because they don't feel confident to do it. But if you look at treatment here, it's part of the internal motivators for that. they are because my doctor told me to go do. It's because I want to see my grandkids and I want to die early. It's because I believe in the treatment, I'm confident in the treatment, and because the other people in my family are helping me or I'm doing it with other folks in that whole aspect. Nothing to do with physically active. So if you do a program that you adherence, you have to build all this communication, then addressing those core motivators that are known for treatment adherence. If you're trying to do the program for physical activity, then you worry about, you know, the look good, feel good type of activity. So that's the whole reason of building a messaging platform in addition to gamification and all those tools, was to be able to deliver all the things Dr. Gaul said in context of what your goals are trying to achieve.
And that's where telehealth comes in. And that's why telehealth has been so relatively successful in reaching people, because you can see the person. So the doctor can see you, you can see the doctor, so you can do that.
I'd like to give two questions as well. One's business, one's technical. Technical first, you showed that you're storing your data on Azure and the keys on AWS. Is there any particular reason for that? Is there a security reason? What's the reasoning behind that, or is it just something?
Absolutely. Yeah. So what we do is when the data comes in from the kiosk, for example, we separate all the PHI out and encrypt it, and separate all the health data out, encrypt it, index it, and put it in Azure and do different stores. And we hash everything, right? And then the keys and linking identifiers are saved in Amazon.
Oh, I see.
So because of doing that, it's no longer considered health data from Microsoft legal point of view. So I don't have to worry about DBA and all this stuff. But there's no NoSQL database that allows you to do that. We have to build our own NoSQL engine on top of Azure. Advantage of doing that in Microsoft and running Azure team kind of knew how to do that stuff, so we'll be able to do it. But if you just look at public data from Microsoft, you won't be able to do it.
I know, I just
wondering
about the separation of
the two.
But it's two different cloud providers as well. You could have used Azure to store the keys as well.
Yeah, but then I have a security problem. Then I have to have a sign a BA with Microsoft because it's a potential breach and something's going to happen.
But you can serve it through a different service,
it needed to be physical separation, what law requires, right, to be able to do that.
And the other question is a business one, and that is, you didn't mention what your business model is. You know, I mean, ultimately, you're in business to make money.
It's very money.
So who's paying for the kiosk? How are you generating revenue?
It's a kiosk per month revenue model. That we lease the kiosk with retailers, and then all other programs and tools are per user, per active user per month model that we
So who's paying?
The retailers and all the partners that I showed you on the list.
Gosh, you sound like my father. Who's paying?
If you don't know who's paying for it, then it's probably not going to happen.
Well, that's not awesome. Who's paying?
Is the question
there? What's the retailer gain from having the kiosk?
So do you know how much revenue they pay for one new undiagnosed hypertensive per year? It's $900. A new diabetic undiagnosed, $1,400. I just need to find them one each per year to cover the cost of the kiosk.
Right, so you're saying, like, I go into Kroger, and I find out from going to the HIGI's kiosk at Kroger that I'm hypertensive, and so now I feel somehow that I should be using Kroger as my...
So those are the tools that we provide to them, and how do you actually message them to do that stuff, right? So when you're hypertensive, then the Kroger program will define what you want them to do, right? So, you know, dial...
So the material I'm getting says Kroger wants you to...
It varies, it is very custom based on what the retailer, how they want it. Mm-hmm. Some people don't want them to talk to the pharmacist, some want them to have a call center call you back later on if you want them to talk to you. Majority of people actually just walk up and talk to them. So that's
I'm in Kroger, I'm now just going to walk over to the Kroger pharmacist kind of type thing?
Yes, if you don't know, you first time sit down, find out you're hypertensive, mm-hmm. Is this, you know, just as if you found out you just got cancer. You want, the behavior is that you want to go talk to somebody. Okay. So what we've seen is that as this becomes a behaviors, so why did we choose retail and all this stuff, right? We wanted to find a trigger that already exists, the habit that already exists, and we want to tie our program to it to get that faster engagement happening. So average adult US person goes to grocery store 1.3 times a week. So we wanted to grab that habit and do it. So as we become habitual, what we realize now is that 56% of our patients who use HIGI stations go use it first before they do shopping. right? So we've actually changed the behavior so much so that more than half of the audience actually goes and does this all the way back of the store, which the retailers love, right? But now you can do impulse buying on the way back. So and then research, you know, some of the retailers have research shown that those people use stations spend $100 more on grocery per month. We've also shown that we have 3.5 times likelihood of buying something if it's recommended on the station. Your recall of the message that you see on the kiosk is 60% more 2 weeks later versus an ad seen on TV or a message seen on the web or something. So we've done all these things to actually build the tools to move the needle for the retailers. That's why they're out there. They're a lot of hands, I don't raise the voice.
Amazing. Is it free for the patient? Meaning is it just a value add that the retailer is offering? Okay. The second is, when do you know with your data set of the population that have used HIGI, what percent that you've newly diagnosed or identified versus ones that are just saying, am I doing a good job of staying on top of things?
Right.
Do you know what that mix is?
So what I don't know is how many of the newly arrived patients at the first time that use it are undiagnosed or they're just not complying with treatment. I don't know how many are show up, so it's a crazy number. 30 last month, so it has changed over time. 33% of our patients who use our HIGI station are hypertensive. So I don't know how many of the new patients are talking about that come.
Just a bug in your ear. If you can get that number with as much scale as you have, that actually helps with understanding from the other side, the payer side, and some of the other sides, which is all the people that never go to the doctor because I'm too stubborn, I don't need to go, right?
Or I just don't want to go.
Yeah, I just don't want to.
I just don't, you know, that's what I get. That's why I'm in the house. I don't want to see you. You know, I'm here to see you. That's different. It's a whole different mindset.
Mm-hmm.
Because when I go to see you, you're going to find something wrong with me. But when you come in my house, I have a better, the thinking is it's better. So I agree, you know, there's a real big concept here that's really important. All these wearables, healthcare is going out in the field. This idea of coming into a clinic, this idea of coming into it's there, but it's not there for me. It's there, and that's why you're going to high traffic areas. This is where people are. You need to be thinking about how to get access to where people are versus saying you need to do the bus and do this and that, because people won't show up. And as they get sicker, they don't show up. And then they show up in the ER, and then we have a crash situation, right? So yeah, I totally agree. High traffic areas, the question is, how do you get that information to the physician? That's the key. You've got a really a reading that's really high. How does that get communicated? That's
why we have new APIs to be able to pull the data.
Yeah.
It's
like
two
more questions.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure.
Wait, one over here.
How do you secure the accuracy of the data? So like these devices are becoming more and more informal. How do you make sure that the data that's input into the device is actually accurate? And have you thought of using it for cancer?
So again, there is one provider that I can't disclose who it is because they're under NDA right now. I was using it to not the kiosk itself, but actually variables to predict to outcomes in post oncology therapy patients. But they're not putting it manually, right? So we do have algorithms to detect. So for example, we can detect if a pet is bearing or it's not you, your kid is bearing, because we immediately see the behavior. Change happened. We've seen people, because we have reward for it, people wear multiple devices. That's why I carry four of them, because I'm one of the guinea pigs who looks for duplication of data. So we do all that stuff on the back end to understand normalized data, look for fraud, look for irregularities. We can detect when you forgot to put your feet on the bar to be able to get the correct weight. So there are ways we can algorithmically, we don't, it's not 100%, we probably miss quite a few, but at least it's better than nothing.
I have a question that I'm interested in. When I was listening to what you were showing, have you gone into the clinical trial world with the large, because in the clinical trial world, you've got population studies, large population studies, so the cardiovascular health studies, or you have this, and the devices are coming into these studies. So it's the actigraph, it's you know, how many hours you're sleeping, falls, especially for elderly, the falls. And you know, measuring joints and all that. Have you gone into that area yet? Has anyone approached you to say we have to get this in the field and we got to do this?
So the oncology is using clinical trial came on, and another one came on in elderly female. So the new standards came out about changing the treatment for 65 plus on the P190. There's concerns on female elderly population, that's probably not true. So there's a clinical trial going on right now that we're part of, in which if there's any patients, too, he has to do this.
Because the prevention trials are exactly where you want to be. Large scale, lots of people coming from everywhere. Then you can measure it to other data, and you still have a PI looking over the data.
So that clinical trial, guess how many patients they enrolled in the week?
Yeah.
7,000.
Yeah.
Target was 2,000.
Yeah.
Right. So it's just sheer volume of patients so much that we can recruit.
So you blew recruitment right out of the window.
Yeah, just recruitment.
That's awesome.
And that's I think that's also happening with things like research kit. That was one of the topics that OpenMHealth had in the past is based research kit. So it's Apple introduced a way to build an easier way to build software on a phone. So you can get mass amounts of people into clinical trials. So if you're a researcher, it's worth looking at something.
And you know, this is an issue because every single trial that I'm involved with and everyone that has never hit their numbers, they're always way behind. They're always, recruitment is always lagging. And I've often thought, if there was a device in that trial for something, I can tell you not only people interested, but even getting them in. And they got to store all the
data. Being academic myself in the past and having done been PI on AIDS for big large scale grants, so I understand. So you know, look at all the tools and all those are primary scenarios. So because I have a very small sales team, majority of my team really is R&D, we focus on a very small portion of our effort where we go and sell our devices and our solutions to. And all these kind of crowd stuff relevant people have heard about us and come and talk to us, we've not actively gone.
So I know that Walgreens is developing a rewards program for their Fitbit, and I was wondering if you guys were exploring kind of like as well about like rewards.
So we pitched to them in 2011, and they said they'll go build it. So the Walgreens, basically that's what we have for retailers, right? We provide the balanced reward as a SaaS solution for every retailer. So Walgreens build their own, but there's other than CVS. Nobody else can build their own rewards program like that. So Fred's Pharmacy in the Southeast is using us as a balanced reward. And we have integration with some of the knowledge programs, and they've plenty for Rite Aid and a few others.
So you're not suggesting Walgreens took your idea and then decided to sell it themselves? Because they never do that,
do they? Oh, absolutely. I've done it a lot of
times.